Good morning, July 28th. It's a Saturday morning, 2012. It's go time. We all need to hear that. It is go time, and those who put the time in now to get going will certainly not regret it, even though the climb seems steep right now. It is not something that will be looked back with, looked back on with regret. So here we are, making another push, believe it or not. And you get up in the morning, you realize you're still miserable, you realize you have to continue to push towards truth. Can a witness to permanence be an impermanent? Can witnessing to permanence be impermanent? Let's say there's someone in the world who tells you that they see permanence as permanent, and then they no longer see it. They say, oh, I don't see it anymore. What kind of witness is that? It's an impermanent witness to permanence. Okay. What we need in this world is a permanent witness to permanence, because only that is going to reassure us that permanence is permanent. If you have an impermanent witness to permanence who's back and forth, you're going to get the impression that permanence is not permanent. That's the feeling that's going to happen. So, a vacillating witness to permanence is not ideal by any means. What is ideal is a permanent witness to permanence. Now, there have been some of those in this world, and I'll show you one right now. There you go. Okay, this one was a permanent witness to permanence. And that leaves a much greater feeling of assurance than a impermanent witness to permanence. I am not a witness to permanence. I am a clarifier to help us recognize what we need, and hopefully moving towards that eventual being a permanent witness to it. But no, not a permanent witness. Not even an impermanent witness at this point, but a clarifier, which is helpful, very helpful. If we can, getting a permanent witness to permanence is the greatest thing there is in this world. The greatest thing there is. Nothing surpasses that. Nothing. Except for our own permanent witnessing to permanence. That's even better. It's even better. But in order to get there, it would be very helpful for a permanent witness to permanence. An impermanent witness, oh my gosh, that can just spin off in so many tangential ways. It really can. It's a problem. Not that some witnessing to permanence isn't a good thing, isn't a helpful thing. Another question, can the impermanent become permanent? Can we have a permanent state of impermanence? Well, that's a contradiction, isn't it? If something's impermanent, how can it be permanent? It cannot. So impermanence that we're seeing here is not permanent. We cannot establish it as permanent. It's still going to be impermanent. We'll get a feeling that it's impermanent. So what we're trying to do in this world, what the ego's trying to do, is to get a permanent situation of impermanence. But we say, where's the beef? Where's the feeling of permanence in this? And he says, well, you're always going to have impermanence. So that's the permanent nature of it. And we say, yeah, but we don't like how it feels. And the ego says, well, you just have to get used to it. And we say, well, I don't think we can get used to it. We want permanence. And the ego says, yeah, but it is permanent. You say, no, it's just going on and on and on. But it's not the feeling of permanence. It's the feeling of impermanence. We want the feeling of permanence. And the ego says, well, there's nothing I can do about that, really. Now, if we had a witness to permanence, that would be a fabulous thing, a permanent witness to it. This is Anandamayi Ma, who was a permanent witness to permanence, did not vacillate, did not one moment witness to permanence and the next moment lose sight of it, never lost sight of it. So that was very helpful. The only problem is that her body was not permanent, right? So it could have been, except that the world wanted some impermanence, didn't feel comfortable with that. So she said, well, then the body age. He says, if you want this body to age and die, it will age and die. Doesn't have to, but if that's what you want, that's what you get. So in other words, the world wanted some wiggle room here. They wanted some wiggle room. We feel very uncomfortable with that which does not decay, does not get sick, does not die, that which is permanent. We get very jittery about it, very jittery. So the fact is that that time has passed. That was, you know, that was the 20th century, mostly the early and mid 20th century was when the her presence of permanent witness to permanence was so strong. And what people say is, hey, what about now? What about now? So it doesn't matter if I show, you know, say, hey, folks, this is a witness. This is a reliable witness because it's a permanent witness to it. Doesn't matter. Because people say, what about now? Yeah, maybe permanence was permanent then, but there's been a lot of changes, so maybe it's not permanent now. So people want to witness now. Now, right now. So I found that it's futile to point out to people there was a witness in this world for 86 years during the most of the 20th century, because they'll say, well, yeah, but you know, all the stuff that's happened after that, look at the technology and the internet and all this kind of stuff, and who's to say that permanence is still permanent and maybe impermanent at this point. So really, the world needs a permanent reassure of permanence right now, which is what I've been saying and saying and saying, and trying to anchor that here in this world, because it's vastly important. An impermanent witness is, again, a mixed message. Mixed message. Some will get some help from it, and others will take it in the wrong way. They'll say, well, that just proves that it's not permanent, that permanence can change into impermanence if there's an impermanent witness to it. Now, I watched Anandamayi Ma, and very carefully, over many, many, many years, her videos and her pictures and her writings, and not her writings, but those who wrote down what she said and how she acted, etc. And for me, I don't see the slightest sign of impermanent witnessing. It's all permanent witnessing. And I say, wow, that is very helpful in any time, any place in this world. Supremely helpful. Doesn't matter what year it is, what place it is, any place in time and space in existence, that's supremely helpful, because you get a profound sense of the permanent, that the permanent really is permanent. It's still permanent. It hasn't become impermanent. And you realize that right now, in the midst of all this stuff, it's still permanent. So the problem is, the world has changed so much since like 1982 when she passed away, and so the people simply disbelieving that the permanent, what they feel is that there's been so much change in the world that it's quite likely that the permanent has changed also. The truth has been changed, you know, that reality has been changed. And so witnesses, you know, to permanence in the past, permanent witness, simply don't have the cachet, the pull in these times. That's what I found. That's what I found out. Very amazing thing, but it's true. at simply the overwhelming change that this world has gone through so fast has left everybody spinning and thinking, oh my gosh, you know, maybe reality really is impermanent, and change is the only situation. Impermanence is really real. It's permanent, so to speak. So I continue to hold out hope that there will be a permanent reassurer of permanence come into the world, but we're running out of time, really running out of time on that. Because the old icons of that don't hold any more weight. That's just a fact. I've worked on this for a long time, trying to use the older examples like Ramana Maharshi and Anamaya Ma. Those are two great examples. And they've just lost their potency because of all the change that's happened. All the change that's happened. People just simply have doubts. You know, doubts have arisen. They don't feel assured that this is a reliable witness. They say, well, maybe back then it was true, but not now. So we're in a bad situation. I don't see anyone in this world right at this point that is a permanent reassurer of permanence. There's some that maybe others would think that they are. That's possible. For me, I don't see anyone of the caliber of a Ramana Maharshi and Anamaya Ma, where it's just so potently, directly discernible that it's just like you're speechless. Just speechless. First time I saw an Anamaya Ma video, I was completely speechless. I was completely stunned. It was like transfixed. I said, oh my, you know, didn't even know, just poof. I said, how can the permanent come into this world like this? But, you know, it's possible. It is possible. Now, how can anybody, anyone reassure us of permanence in this world, have a permanent reassurance of permanence? How is it possible? Because obviously we're thinking, or we will, that like, wait a minute, you know, what are they seeing that is so permanent? How can they know on a permanent basis? Because we go to sleep, right? When we're sleeping, we don't know that it's permanent. So let me answer that question. One thing Anandamayi Ma said, she never slept. Her body, she'd lay her body down in a heap, but she said her consciousness, her awareness, never slept at all. Never. Not even for a moment. She was perfectly wide awake constantly. The body may be going through the sleeping thing, but she said she never experienced a break in her awareness at all as far as going into any sleep. No. So there's one answer to that. Secondly, you say, how can our eyes, our senses, be perceiving permanence? The answer is they can't. They cannot. Now, she said she didn't use her senses to see. That whether eyes were open or eyelids are open or closed made absolutely no difference. Was not using. She says we have a spiritual vision that is not based on the body. And it's perfectly pure and immaculate and never sleeps, is never subject to fatigue, and that spiritual sense can see permanence, along with the shadows of this world that we call impermanence. But it sees permanence primarily, clearly, without a doubt. Doesn't get tired, doesn't get injured, is not subject to energy, subject to nature at all. This is called inner vision, the vision of Christ. And unless we have that vision of Christ, there's no way we can reassure everyone about permanence on a permanent basis. Cannot. Because our senses, of course, they're subject to fatigue, they're subject to injury, they're subject to all sorts of stuff, and all they see in this world is impermanence. That's it. They only see impermanence. So there's no way that you can do it by using the senses. And her testimony was she didn't use the senses. other words, the body really wasn't involved in the reassurance at all. Body was just there as a focal point, so for people to relate to. But the awareness, the vision of permanence and perfection was not, it was not based on the body. It was not based on the body at all. And that's the same testimony A Course in Miracles gives, that Jesus says that you have to have a vision of Christ. It's called spiritual vision. Must awaken in you before you can see permanence. Excuse me. Well, out of water. So you cannot reassure anybody by using the body senses, which only see, which are themselves impermanent, right? The body's going to die. So the senses are impermanent. So whatever they're seeing, is their assurance is going to stop at some point. And then you can say, well, you know, it didn't seem like a permanent reassurance. And whatever they see is impermanent. So how can that which is relying on the body's senses give any assurance of permanence whatsoever? It's not possible. Not possible. Here's a little more water. So, there has to be this inner vision. Spiritual vision has to awaken. And it's that spiritual vision that is capable of permanently seeing permanence, reality. And they're then reassuring everyone that, yeah, reality is still real. Permanence is still permanent and always will be. And that's the assurance that we need to pull out of this tailspin. We're in a tailspin. We're like in a free fall. We're a tailspin spiraling down and down and down and down and down into this abyss. And, you know, we can't pull out of it. We cannot pull out of it. And we're trying all sorts of rudder adjustments of the plane, tilt this, tilt that. All the instrument panels wrong. We don't know where we are. We're like that Air France flight off of the coast of Brazil where everything went wrong. All the instruments got jammed, clogged, not giving right readings, and they thought they were going up when they were really going down and all this kind of stuff. And just plunging down. Caught in the net of our own, of actually this idea of believing that we can be prime creator. It's that belief, it's that desire. It's a desire first. Actually, it's a whim first. It's a desire second. It's a belief third, and a faith fourth. And all of those lead us into believing that truth is no longer true, that it's impermanent. It's an inescapable consequence of this idea of this whim that we want to be prime creator. Inescapable consequence of it. There's no way around it. And I pointed out in the previous video, so the way out of this tailspin is to come across a witness to permanence. And then that says, whoa, you know, it's like suddenly you pull out of the tailspin. Something's flying your plane in the right way. And you say, wait a minute, permanence is permanent. And you can get a glimpse of permanence, but then when you lose that glimpse, then you start thinking, maybe it's not so permanent because I don't see it anymore. That's the problem, right? Is our means of perception are themselves impermanent. So how can an impermanent means of perception accurately perceive permanence? It's not possible. It's not possible. So we pull away from that vision of permanence, that seeing it for a glimpse, because we think we're going to lose something if we see it any longer. Yeah, we're going to lose the belief that impermanence is permanent, or that it's even possible, that it's even real. We're going to lose that. And we're going to lose the belief, the faith, and we're going to lose the belief, and we're going to lose the desire, and then we're going to lose the whim to be prime creator. But again, is the loss of the loss actually a loss? Is the sacrifice of nothing actually a sacrifice? That is the question. Is the impermanence of impermanence actually impermanence? It is not. So truth is still true, but we don't, when we pull away from that, we think, oh, I don't see it, so it must be impermanent. Where is it? It disappeared on me. I gotta find a way to make it permanent. So we are busy in our laboratory here, a laboratory of existence, trying to find a way to make stuff permanent, thinking that it's up to us to save reality, because reality has become impermanent, but we can fix it, we can heal it, you know, and make it whole, and make it unified, and make it one again. So we're trying to, all this well-intentioned stuff in the world, let's bring harmony and oneness and peace and healing and all this together in the world, let's do this. It's an attempt to heal reality, to heal impermanence, but reality doesn't need any healing, it doesn't need any fixing, it doesn't need any harmonizing, it doesn't need any oneness and anything like that. It never was impermanent in the first place. Our whim, desire, belief, and faith that we want to be prime creator means that we have to change reality, because in reality we're not prime creator, which means we have to change truth, which means we have to have faith and belief and desire and whim to change truth. Have to believe, therefore, that truth is impermanent. If we knew, we couldn't change truth. There's no way we can entertain this idea. There's no way we can entertain it, because we'd know we can't change what we are, because we are truth. God's laws extend through all creation, and we are part of God's creation, and so if we want to change that, we have to change truth. If we believe we can change truth, that means truth is not permanent. And again, how can you have a truth that isn't permanent? What kind of truth is that? It's no truth at all. That's like saying it's true now, but it's a lie later. So if that's the case, it never was true. So we believe then that truth is no longer true. And there is no truth. They're just impermanence. And it's a very unstable, chaotic, unstable, scary situation. And therefore, we think we need to fix it. We need to make it permanent. And so that's why we have all these efforts in the world by well-intentioned, righteous mindsets to let's harmonize, let's fix, let's heal, let's get some sense of stability and permanence in the world. That is not the way. That is not the way. The way is to let's come across a witness to a permanent witness to permanence, a permanent witnessing, a witnessing that is permanent while their body is here, understanding that we don't tolerate bodies remaining here forever. So Ananda, my ma, said, she said, I'm always with you. This permanent witnessing is always with you, but your desire to see, have this body live a normal lifespan is bringing about the demise of this body. So you won't have this body anymore here. But she says the vision of Christ, the vision of permanence, the vision of reality is a permanent vision. I have it always, and it's always true, and it's always with you, always available to you. Which is just vision of Christ, vision of permanence is available to everybody at every moment. Everyone's pre-qualified to experience this. It's just that we don't want to, or we're afraid. Because it would then, obviously, we would, all our efforts to fix impermanence would, no more, wouldn't need them. We said, we'd say, oh my gosh, reality has always been permanent. Permanence has always been permanent. I'm just dreaming of impermanence. I don't need to do anything to fix impermanence. Even if I could, I cannot fix it anyway, but there's absolutely no reason to whatsoever. I only need to awaken from this dream. And that would be it. That's it. So we're afraid of losing our spiritual image, because our spiritual image in this world is based on trying to fix permanence, fix impermanence, make impermanence feel better. Because right now it feels very impermanent, and we don't like it. So we're trying to please the ego. The ego says, come on, guys, get with it. feel better about yourselves here. What's the problem? You're all creative. You should be able to do this. And we say, yeah, that's right. We have all these, we're infinitely creative. We should be able to do this. And the ego says, yeah, come on, get her done. You can do it. And so we're struggling. And, you know, the minstrels come out with their songs and, oh, love, peace, and oneness, and harmony, and bliss, and healing, and everyone sings, and they feel, ah, oh, this is great, we're getting there, and we're trying to spread, you know, all these beautiful ideals throughout the world, and everybody's working so hard. That's called spiritual image, an image of trying to fix impermanence, make it better. That's what we would lose. That's what we're afraid to lose, among other things. I mean, there's a whole complex. We're afraid of losing all our complexes that are based on trying to adjust to impermanence as our home. Right? All those complexes are trying to adjust to permanence as our home. Get rid of those irritating elements that are causing us to feel so impermanent, right? And those people across the street, you know, the guy is grinding the stones, cutting the stones. And all these things that are irritating us, saying, hey, that's causing me to feel terrible. I feel very impermanent. I feel very impermanent here. Gosh, I don't like that. So let's get rid of the stuff. So you have righteous movements, righteous crusades, righteous infiltrations, righteous laws, all the stuff that's designed to get rid of what's irritating a particular group. And everybody who's part of these movements, truly, they really believe that whatever their irritations are, whatever their angle is, that's the right angle. That's the others that are wrong. Everybody believes that. Everybody is a true believer. And surely people say that you can't possibly be against this. Surely you can't possibly be for that. You know, that's just obvious irritation, you know. But the effort comes from all angles. So there's never any agreement, any universal agreement on how to fix impermanence. Why? Because it cannot be fixed or made whole at all. Nothing works. So people, literally, complexes continuously arise trying different angles, continuously. There will never be any peace in impermanence, only conflict and self-righteousness. And righteous indignation, and righteous hatred, and righteous crusades, righteous conflicts, battles, laws, systems of pressure and demands, and, constantly. And those who do that, they feel so righteous about it. How can anyone be against us? They say, if they're against us, they must be crazy. They need psychiatric care, lock them up. They must be crazy, because how could they be against this righteous drive towards oneness here? Everybody, you know, sharing the oneness and the harmony so we can all be happy here in the realm of impermanence. Well, the secret is that we can never be happy with impermanence, because we are permanent. And this dream of impermanence, it just, we hate it. We can't stand it. It's terrible. We can never learn to love it. It's impossible. It's just a nightmare. It's just a horrible nightmare, really. And so we crave permanence. It's just that we keep going about it in the wrong way. We keep trying to make impermanence permanent, or find some island of permanence within it. The right way, though, to go about it is the desire to have a witness, a permanent witness to permanence, to remember permanence. Path of remembrance, that reality has always been permanent. Truth has always been true. It hasn't ceased to be true because our crazy whim, desire, belief, and faith has have no effect on it whatsoever. And so we need to be reassured about this fact. Instead of trying to fix impermanence, be reassured that permanence is permanent, and that our home is still perfect for us. And then, of course, our spiritual resume of trying to fix impermanence is no longer relevant. Our spiritual image is no longer relevant. it's a tough thing to do, to let go of that, because we believe our happiness depends upon it. Really. It's very tough. The spiritual path is tough, difficult. It's kind of nerve-wracking because we realize that we're being asked to part with our spiritual image and all these efforts to fix impermanence, make it better. And we're going to drop out of that and lose all credence within that. You know, nobody within the hierarchy of the effort to make impermanence permanent and feel good for us is going to promote us at all or even recognize us or anything. So just we feel like we'll be low person on the totem pole, which is true. I've been there for a long time, and it's not easy. It's not easy. But you know that it's right. You know you're going in the right direction, so you continue on. The effort to make impermanence permanent is delusion. That is what's called the Antichrist, path of the Antichrist, path of the ego, path of darkness. Even though on that path of darkness, everybody's talking about light, love and light and peace. They're always saying love and light and peace as they work to make the impermanent permanent. What else are they going to say? You got to believe it to keep working on it. But that's folly. It's folly. And here, we are turning towards the realization that the permanent is permanent. Always has been, always will be. Truth is true. Always has been, always will be. And we need to be reassured of this fact. So, in my case, I found some reassurers and believed what they had to reassure me about, and then use the voice of reason within, which we all have. The Prime Creator put a new creation within us. It manifests as the voice of reason in this world that can see that truth must be true, can see truth. But it's not as permanent as the vision of Christ. It points out, it works within our illusions and deceptions and confusions, etc., to clearly point out the truth. I can see it must be so, it must be so. But we're always free to turn away from it and say, well, okay. It's like a friend that you either pay attention to a little while and then ignore for a little while. And it's not bothered. But the vision of Christ, the actual vision of seeing, a spiritual vision, can be a permanent thing unless we pull back from it. It can be a seamless seeing of truth, which is, you know, effective for reassuring others. Voice of reason is effective for reassuring ourselves. But if we want to be helpful to others, we have to have this vision of Christ. It has to be a permanent, seamless reassurance. If others come to us and start asking all these questions, basically they're saying, hey, how do you know that it's the permanent and truth has not been harmed? How do you know? And you have to be able to say, right now, because I'm seeing it. I'm seeing it right now. In order for them to get motivated to then use the voice of reason within to sort things out and see how this must be so. It must be so. So I got that reassurance, and then I used the voice of reason to sort it all out. The assurance came to me through like the presence of Ananda Maima, who I said, this one, it reassured me completely. I said, flawless reassure. Seamless, that truth is still true, that the permanent is still permanent. And then I said, okay, it's just up to me to use the voice of reason and sort it out and come to the point where I can also accept this on a seamless basis. That's how it works. It's very important that people get this sense of seamless reassurance that the permanent is still permanent. And they feel that this reassurance is permanent, that it's there, then they will turn towards the voice of reason, which will then help them sort out and undo their defenses and lose their fear of letting go of nothing, of impermanence, which is nothing, really. It's just a supposition. It's a hope, a wish, a belief, a faith that this eventually replaces permanence, but it will never do so. So it's really nothing. So the willingness to get to, got to get to that point where you're willing to be a seamless, permanent reassurer. That's what we're aiming towards, so we can help others. You know, that's, so there is a way to do that. There is a way to do that, but it requires, it's extremely helpful if we have a permanent reassurer, one who's seamless in their reassuring of permanence. It's extremely helpful. And right now, I can't find one. I can't really find one, which is disconcerting. So someone would say, well, why don't you be one? You know, that's what some say. And I said, well, if it happens, it happens. But it cannot happen unless there's a vision, inner vision. Without inner vision, it's impossible. You cannot do it. You can only, you can't work at the level of motivation strongly enough at all. And so people will kind of listen and say, yeah, but I just don't feel motivated enough myself to do it. They can say, I see you're doing it, you're motivated, but I don't feel the same level of motivation. But, and I say, well, I got this level of motivation because I was given the help that I needed. If you don't get the help you needed, how can you have the right enough motivation? It's not possible. Even if you catch a glimpse of truth, that's the very potent. But I've found you need boosts along the way. And because you'll say, well, I saw reality was permanent 10 years ago, but so much has changed, maybe it's not permanent anymore. And that's a severe problem. It undermines motivation. So as I went along, I would meet up with these perfect reassurers of permanence, these permanent reassurers of permanence, and then I'd say, wow, you know, it was that way for their whole entire lives, and they said it will always be that way, so I really believe them. And then that kept the motivation going. So it's not, motivation is a difficult thing to generate. You have to really fight for it, because it's always being undermined by everything we're seeing in the world. Everything we're seeing in the world undermines our spiritual path, undermines it. Almost everything, other than coming across teachers and reassurers. Because the constant change, constant impermanence, even our senses are diminishing, changing all the time. I notice that. And so I say, well, I'm not being reassured by the world at all. The only thing that reassures me is the voice of reason and those teachers, the permanent reassurers of permanence. So again, I keep saying we need a permanent reassurer of permanence. An impermanent reassurer of permanence is a contradiction in terms and is not anywhere near as effective as a permanent reassurer. And we need one that we can just, you don't need to really ask questions of those, really. You just need to see them. You just like, you feel something like, wow, this is seamless. How can this possibly be seamless? In this world, everything changes. It's the peace beyond understanding that Jesus talked about. As we look at these permanent reassurers, I'll click on the picture again. We study them very carefully, and after a while we start to get this feeling, odd feeling, like, wait a minute, what's going on here? Because there's some attitude or mood that they have that doesn't change, that you feel is permanent. And no matter what happens, around them or in their facial expressions or whatever, there's something there that is permanent. That's complete certainty, permanent certainty. And that eventually you feel it and you say, wait a minute, you know, what's going on here? What is this? What is this? It seems like it's unbelievable. Certainly you're going to see some change, some impermanence in that sense of assurance that they have, the sense of confidence of something they have. You're certain that it can't be stable, and yet you're seeing that it is stable. And there's this amazing feeling like, how is that possible? It has to be unstable, and yet it's stable, and I don't know how to process this, really. And you say, something isn't right. You don't know exactly. Something isn't right. And then, you know, then you try to sort it out. You sort it out. It's like a conundrum. It's a conundrum. Most people are not up to the challenge of this. I mean, you come across like Ananda Maima, there's a conundrum there. And you realize there's something you need to sort out, because you thought you thought you had figured pretty much everything out in this world, and then this you cannot figure out. It's a conundrum. You thought, you know, everyone thinks they pretty much know it all. You come across like Ananda Maima, a perfect reassurer of permanence, a permanent reassurer, and you cannot put it together. You cannot put it together. Because how can you have the sense of permanence within impermanence? It's not even an effort, you know. It's like you at least see some effort she's making. No effort. It's effortless. Complete confidence. It's just like it is. And we say, no, that's not possible. And yet we're seeing it. And so we say, well, maybe our perception's crazy. And so if our perception's crazy, you know, how do we know anything then? And it's all these, you know, it's a conundrum. You can't figure it out. And then you start working to sort that out, sort it out. If you have the capacity, willingness to do so. We all have the capacity, but the willingness to do so is important, because if we want to establish permanence and impermanence, and here's something that's already permanent, so we'll think, wait a minute, how did she do that? And it throws us for a loop. It throws us for a loop. And we say, how did you do that? And she says, I've always been this way. And we say, wait a minute, well, how's that possible? Must have been some process. She goes, no process. And whatever we try to come up with, it doesn't fit. And, you know, our integrity, you know, depends. If you're a person of integrity, if you're a person of intellectual integrity, you'll say, wait a minute, I cannot explain this, and it doesn't fit within anything that I've seen or I can even understand. And if I'm supposedly a person, a very intelligent person of integrity, how can I be incapable of explaining this, of understanding this, and have no theory or any way to truly fit this into? I cannot. And then you decide whether you're just gonna somehow do some little, you know, magic trick with it and think that it's solved. Don't worry about it. Sweep it under the rug, or you're going to take on the challenge and say, "How is this possible? How is this possible?" If you take on that challenge, you start digging into it and you start finding out answers. Vision of Christ, spiritual vision. Reality is still real. This world is a dream. Impermanence is a dream. You start bringing these factors in, and then you start saying, "Aha! Aha! Now I see maybe what's going on here." So it's a challenge. It's really a challenge. And most people don't want that challenge. So they want somebody who's an impermanent reassurer of permanence, because then there's no challenge, you see? And that's the problem that I fell into and many fall into, is that out of compassion, you want to help others. And when you see that there's very few who want to take up the real challenge, you say, well, let me make it a little easier. Let me be an impermanent witness to permanence. And then they don't feel challenged, so they come to you. They come to the guru who is an impermanent witness to permanence, because the challenge there is not the challenge. They say, oh, well, you know, it's impermanent, so it fits. It fits what they're trying to do. There's still some permanence within impermanence. So it fits, and everyone says, hallelujah, let's make this guru the queen of the universe. And all we need to do is bow down and worship and praise and thank you and all this stuff. But if you get a permanent witness to permanence, there is a conundrum. There's a problem. It doesn't fit. And there's a challenge. So, the problem is, anyone in this world, you know, you see those who are not up to the challenge, and you say, wow, I wish I could help them too. And then you drop vision of permanence, and then they say, ah. And they say, oh, that's great. Yeah, I see you're one of us. You're one of those who believe that you can establish permanence in impermanence. Welcome, welcome, welcome. You're so skilled at it. How did you do it? Tell us the process. Help us out. Help us do it. And then, you know, you have all sorts of followers who fellow travelers on that way. It's a bad scene. It's not good. So there's that trap. It's a difficult thing. Very few permanent reassurers of permanence in this world. Very few. Because like Ananda Mayama said, not many came to her up to the challenge, who accepted the challenge that she presented to our worldview, to our whole belief system, to our faith system, all of that. Not many were up for the challenge. But she didn't drop down. She said, you got to get yourself going so you're up for it. You know, start working out, as it were, spiritually. Get in spiritual shape so you're up for the challenge. That's what she told us. And people complain to her, say, ah, you're too tough. You know, it's too difficult. Can't you, you know, be a little less the way you are? And she just laugh, you know, and say, well, how about this? How about you give a little more effort? How about you give 5 more minutes a day towards spiritual clarification? How about that? That's what she'd say. So nobody was able to crack that egg. She just said, give it more effort. If you're not up for the challenge, you need to get in better shape. It's like running a marathon. If people are not in shape, they say, ah, can't you make it like a half marathon? Or can't you just make it 1 mile, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And the organizers have to say, no, it's a marathon. You got to finish the full marathon. So you have to take on the full challenge. One way or the other, and see that it's not that you need to fix impermanence in any way, do anything. It's you simply need to realize that permanence is still permanent. That's it. If permanence is still impermanent, then what relevancy does impermanence have at all? Because it was literally the belief that permanence is not permanent. That's all that it is. Nothing more than that. And all the efforts we've made in impermanence have been based on the belief that permanence is not permanent, and therefore we need to make the house of impermanence a home for ourselves. And we need to give it the feeling of permanence, because it's bugging us. This impermanence really bugs us. You know. That's it. So once we realize that the permanent is still permanent, there's no more relevancy or use for impermanence. It was just the belief that that permanence wasn't permanent. That's all. So I've been hoping that there'd be enough people in this world up to the challenge so that we could have a permanent reassure of permanence. But very difficult to. At this time, it seems like everyone is like desperately struggling with all the massive changes that are taking place on every different level. Change is now, you know, digital. High tech, I mean, it's on steroids. The planet is on steroids, severely, really. And there's so much change going on that people just feel overwhelmed by it. And they're so overwhelmed, they take a defensive position of saying, well, we just have to assume that all this is for the best, and it's going to establish a sense of permanence for me. They assume it because they're so overwhelmed by it. Very few in this world can look at all this change and just dismiss it, you know, and say, no, it's not overwhelming. Very difficult. Which is why the spiritual path was so important during the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s. Before the internet, before the, you know, computers and the internet arrived, and all this digital stuff arrived. So now, you know, you say, no, I'm not overwhelmed by it. I'm not deceived by it. I don't have to take a blind defensive position. Well, a supposition that it must be for the good, because I can't really keep up with it. It's overwhelming. So I just have to pray and believe that it's all for the good and it's going to establish what I want. And of course, what we know that nothing that we want can ever be established in impermanence. Can impermanence remove impermanence? Can the impermanent remove the feeling of impermanence? Is that really true, or is it just a magic show? It's just a magic show. So you may be hearing this and you may be feeling you're not up to the challenge. Don't sell yourself short. Don't sell yourself short. I was up to the challenge, so you can be too. I'm no better than anyone else. All the capabilities I have, same capabilities everybody has. Everyone has the tenacity. It's just that people are feeling overwhelmed right now. By design. I mean, it's an overwhelming time we live in. Overwhelming time. Has been for quite some time. It's just even worse now. Getting overwhelmed with the trends and the changes, which are just colossal socially. The decay that is creeping in to this civilization, to the world culture, the decay is just unbelievable. We're glossing it over. The worse it gets, the more glossy images we need to look at. More models, you know, glossy, pretty models we need to see in the world saying, you know, look at this car, look how beautiful it is. Yeah, we're really looking at the model, not the car. If you look at the car, you say, wait a minute, that car is like, it's a junker, you know. And then we say, well, let's have two models on the car. Look at this beautiful car here. And the worse the car gets, the more beautiful models we need to surround it by. So we're looking at the beautiful models and not the junky car. Civilization is collapsing. The more it collapses, the more beautiful models we need to need to be constantly front and center in the world. So that we're not focusing on the car, we're not focusing on the decay, the impermanence, how sickly it all is. We're not focusing on that. We're looking at the models. It's all a magic show here. It's all misdirection. Marketing, advertising, misdirection, keeping us from seeing what's going on. We're distracting us because we're overwhelmed, and we just say, I hope this is all going the right direction, and then all the pretty models are singing and dancing, you know, and we say, oh yeah, that's nice, distracting us from taking a clear look at the picture and realizing, holy cow, it's an avalanche. It's like we're in a little village, the avalanche is coming down, someone peeks over the wall and they say, oh my gosh, an avalanche is coming. And then all the people say, what? And suddenly all these pretty models are singing and dancing in the sound square and doing all their cheerleading, etc. And they say, hey, everybody, come here. You know, and people look at that and say, oh, that's really neat. That's very pretty. I like that. And then someone else is saying, hey, everybody, look over the wall. Look up on the mountain, avalanche is coming down. and more cheerleaders come in. Trying to keep everyone in the village because purpose of existence is sacrifice. It's loss. It's impermanence. The more that we, when we start getting suspicious of impermanence, what does impermanence do? Brings about more impermanence. More intense impermanence, more intense loss. So the world is headed towards a global sacrifice. And we believe that this saves us from annihilation. In other words, a loss of physical life somehow saves us from spiritual annihilation. So the plan is to sacrifice everyone on this planet. And all those cheerleaders, those glossy models, are trying to keep everyone's attention on them instead of on the avalanche that's coming, the sacrifice that's coming. Very simple misdirection. Very simple misdirection. If you take your attention away from that, all the beautiful people, the beautiful models, all the glamour and the glitz and all of that, and you look what's really happening, then you say, oh my gosh, this is a global sacrifice. This is on its way. And you say, I want to bail out of here. I want to bail out. I don't want that. I don't need more evidence of impermanence, because I know impermanence is unreal. Just and I know it can't be fixed. Can't be made true. It cannot be made permanent. Cannot be made permanent. So there's no use for sacrifice at all. It's a waste of time. Waste of time. So let's bail out. Let's bail out of this situation. If a villager sees the avalanche coming in this walled village is coming right for him, the villager's going to run out through the village gate and head on down the road. The smart ones do. The wise ones do. The rest of them are all ogling the cheerleaders, you know. And, you know, they say, come on, guys, this is a collective effort. You know, we all need to pull together. We all need to have this harmony and oneness. And here we are. Look how beautiful we are. You're going to have a beautiful world where everyone's going to be beautiful. We'll all be beautiful people together. That's the theme. We'll all be this beautiful. We'll all be so sexy and beautiful and wonderful. We'll all be living the high roller lifestyle, you know. We'll all have all this money and pleasure and travel and everything. It'll be so wonderful. How could you possibly leave this? How wonderful it is. Look at these glossy photos and brochures, and look how great it's going to be. Just got to hang in there. That's the constant message we're getting in this world. So we think, wow, if we bail out, we're going to miss all this. But what's coming is global sacrifice. That's loss, impermanence, amplifying itself, trying to amplify itself. Trying to say, look, this impermanence is permanent. You cannot leave. There is nothing else. That's what it's trying to do. It says, there is nothing else. Look how powerful impermanence is. Look how it's reasserting its permanence by, you know, global sacrifice. You see how impermanence is so permanent? It's inescapable. Inescapable. That's the message. It's inescapable. So, of course, all the cheerleaders are here saying, it's inescapable, guys. Don't even think about it. Look how beautiful we are. Stay here. Stay here. Siren. That's called the Song of the Sirens. And I could go on and on and on. The marketing campaign is very extensive. The misdirection campaign is very extensive. Extremely so. So we're in this situation, you know. Some of us have looked over the wall and say, here comes the avalanche. Let's get out of here, so to speak, you know. Let's head on down the road. Let's head on down the road to realization that truth is always true and that permanence is always permanent. Let's head on down that road. Let's head on down that road. The road of realization. Head on down that road. And it stands to reason that at some point, heading on down that road may be a literal thing too. Right now it's a figurative thing we're speaking of, because we're aligning our intention in a certain direction. aligning our willingness and our intention and our clarity, accepting the challenge. Everyone can accept the challenge. I accepted it, and you know, it was fun. It was real fun. Not the gaudy glitz, the tinsel of Tinseltown fun. Not that. It was real fun, because it was fun to see your mistakes, to uncover your mistakes. It's like, wow, that mistake is really part of what's binding me to death and misery and suffering. It was a lot of fun to see that. You know, done with that. So it's an extremely interesting, fun challenge to say, how in the world, you know, can there be a witness to permanence within impermanence? How is that possible? It's not even coming from impermanence. If it was, it wouldn't be seamless. How is it possible? Take the challenge up of realization, of remembrance. Take it up. It's really real fun. Real fun. Instead of the superficial junk garbage that the world is offering us. There are new gambling establishments being authorized, approved all the time. One was just authorized here in the Bay Area yesterday. Big, huge, new, glitzy gambling establishment. Gambling palace, as it were. You know, all the hostesses and hosts and hostesses are, you know, they're in their glamorous attire, and there's drinks, glamorous drinks, and high rollers come and get the real expensive stuff, and the lighting is so cool. There's shows and everything. You know. It's like the whole world is being turned into a Las Vegas, as it were. Everybody saying, come on, this is fun, fun, fun. That's not real fun at all. I've had more fun than that, really. Just uncovering the lies, the deceptions, the double binds. Uncovering all of that is really fun. Because that's just one more nail that you've taken out of your coffin. I'm telling you, taking the lid off your coffin is quite fun. You know, you pry this nail, and you pry it, and you pry it, and you pry it, and you work at it, and finally, pops off. And you say, that's one less nail in my coffin. And that's fun. And then you get the cat's paw, crowbar, and you're working on the next nail, and you take the, you know, trying to cut it, trying to find a way to get that nail out, and finally, boom, that nail's been cut. You say, wow, that was a lot of fun working on that one. And then you go to the next one, and you keep at it, and you step back, like, wow, I've taken a lot of nails out of the lid of my coffin. That's great. It's a lot of fun doing that. And you keep at it. That's real fun. That's real fun. You look at those people who have been involved in this tinsel, glitter, and fake fun. They're miserable. Can any of them witness like I'm witnessing now? Can any of them? The answer is no. Look at them, and you suddenly catch the fatigue, the weariness, the desperation, the hopelessness, the dispiritedness. You know, just this, they just feel, they look crushed. And yet, boom, they can put on their makeup and their gowns and everything and do a song and dance and say, oh, look, everybody, let's have fun. Look how much fun I'm having. Let's all have fun. And afterwards, you know, it's just like, oh, I need more booze, more drugs. And not having fun. They're having misery. But getting those nails out of your lid of your coffin is a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. It's hard work. It's tough work, sure. But it's fun. It's honest work. It's the work you feel like, you know what? I'm really proud that I did that work. That feels great to me that I did that work. That's that kind of work. It's that kind of work. The other stuff doesn't have that feel to it whatsoever. So take up the challenge. Take up the challenge. During these times, take up the challenge. Don't be afraid of it. Go down that road. Go down the road toward realization. Make that your focus. Make that your intention. Make that your purpose. You say, you know what? I'm gonna give it my best go. I may not be in shape now, but I know I can get in shape. Definitely can get in shape. For example, I started out making short videos, made them a little longer, a little longer, a little longer, a little longer, and now I can talk however long I want. The limit on this is, like, Ustream is 3 hours. I could go on and on. In other words, capable of a marathon. I didn't start out capable of a marathon. So you can literally, you can get in shape. You can get in shape. You can get in spiritual shape. You can get capable to accept the challenge of remembrance. Accept the challenge of coming across a permanent, flawless, seamless reminder of permanence. That you see, this is not going to change. This is permanent. This presence that I'm seeing is permanent. There is never going to waver or vacillate or anything. It's permanent. You say, wow, I thought everything was impermanent. So what is it in impermanence that's permanent? And it's just, wow, what's going on? And of course, the people will run off in tangents about this, and they'll say, well, we just need to bow to this, and but there's a real challenge there that you need to take up. You can't, it's not enough to just say, love you, love you, love you, wonderful, wonderful. That's good, that's helpful. But there's a challenge there too. You have to take up the challenge. You say, wait a minute, how is this possible? How is it possible? How is this really possible? My integrity depends on answering this question. Because if I can't answer, what kind of intellectual integrity do I have? You know, I was brought up an intellectual in circles of academia and all of that. And I had tremendous feeling of integrity is important. Like a scientist, you have to have integrity. You have to check your facts. You have to be right. You cannot. So when I came across Ananda Mahima, I said, wait a minute. You know, how in the world can I claim intellectual integrity when I can't even explain this? And this is very, very important. I can see it's incredibly important. I don't even understand it. Can't explain it, really. Where is my integrity? And I said, you know, this is a challenge. I gotta figure this out somehow. I gotta really get it. Because otherwise, I don't really have integrity. I can't really project it. Cannot. And I see now intellectuals projecting integrity. I know they don't have any. They don't really have it. They don't. So I'm not. One moment, please, here. One moment, please. All right, we got the stone cutting going on, we got the helicopter above, and then we have, so I needed to talk with someone, we have all that going on, and it's all good, it's all good. So, being an intellectual, being raised in that whole environment, and then recognizing that there was no real integrity to it, if we couldn't answer these fundamental, extremely important challenges, we didn't take those up, how can we claim integrity? So now I look, you know, I'm not intimidated by intellectuals at all. Just I see they don't have real integrity. They don't have it because they're dismissing. They haven't taken up the challenge, the real challenge. They just refuse to meet up with that challenge. I was willing to meet up with it, and it was a big challenge. But until one meets up with that challenge of seeing that the permanent is permanent, and even seeing that someone in this world can give witness to that the permanent is permanent, there's like a massive hole in integrity and in understanding. It just isn't there. The world is guided by intellectuals. There's an elite stratification of society, which is inhabited by intellectuals. And those are the think tank people, the policy makers, the high level bureaucracy, etc. And they basically decide, you know, directions of culture and society and all this stuff. And then the politicians pretty much have all these policy papers that they use to, and then they come up with a nice little speech. But the high echelons is the angels. And so I know for a fact that they don't have integrity. So they can't lead the world properly at all. They do not, they're not taking up, they're so busy trying to get their PhDs and get in high positions in these, you know, cultural think tank areas, like, you know, here got Berkeley and Stanford is a major one. There's a whole institution, elite institution, an organization of all these elites, intellectuals who try to steer the ship of the world, and they have a massive hole. They're so busy trying to, you know, get power and position that they don't have time for the challenge. In my case, I was so ill that I couldn't gain any position. So I said, what else, you know, what can I do? I say, here's this challenge. I said, wow, this really challenges me, my integrity. I got to understand this. I have to figure it out. Of Course in Miracles, same thing. Voice of Reason, seeing the permanence, all that is a tremendous challenge to mental integrity, intellectual integrity. And so spent all my time working on that instead of getting, you know, degrees and PhDs. And, you know, I could have been one of the elites, intellectual elites, easily, but my path went different than that. But I can easily see through the intellectual elites. I know for a fact they have not taken up the challenge. They don't know what they're talking about as far as how to truly help the world. They don't know how. And so you basically got blind leaders of the blind. It's like someone captaining a ship that can't even see. You know, you're going to hit the reef. You're going to hit the reef for sure. The boat's going to capsize. And their ideas really are nothing. They don't have any ideas, not really. It's just basically, how do we make impermanent seem more permanent? That's it. Which is not an idea at all. It's nothing. It's an absence of integrity, really. Because what they should be saying is, how do we remember that permanence has always been permanent? That's, you know, integrity says that, and nothing but that. How do we remember that? That's the only question we really need to address in this world. How do we remember that permanence has always been permanent? How do we do that? Only one question to start off with, that's it. We take up that challenge. How do we remember? And some are working on that. Some are working on that. In this world, there are some. Probably hidden all over the place, you know, obscure. Nobody knows who they are, maybe. And there's little, you know, there's teachers sprinkled here and there in the world. And some have got this sense of permanence. At least they say they do. So even if a permanent reassure of permanence came into the world, they wouldn't be met with complete apathy. There would be some who would take up the challenge and would be helped by that. There really would be. I don't know if it's just inconsequential or not, but they would be helped. But of course, it's not going to go mainstream because the intellectual elites who have spent all their lives and efforts on generating an image of intellectual integrity, you know, they're going to say, whoa, this is, undermines our status. people might find out we don't have any clothes. The emperor has no clothes. And there's been a desperate attempt to prop up the intellectual establishment in many ways through the universities, through the changes in universities, and new types of intellectuals coming in that, let's say, nobody dares challenge our integrity, which is what feminism basically is. We've basically taken over the university systems, and basically the idea is that nobody can dare challenge our integrity because we are a woman, hear us roar, you know, nobody can challenge us. It's a way of propping up the intellectual elite. It's a way of making it seem unassailable, that nobody can see through it. Because people were challenging the authority of the intellectuals during the 60s, and then what happened was feminism saw the opportunity to, you know, to shore that up, to save it, and they rushed in to save it. And now a lot of that is supported in by that way, by feminism, and it seems unassailable. Nobody can challenge the integrity of the mother, so to speak. That's unassailable. Nobody can do that. So kind of wrapping up the whole intellectual establishment in the skirt of the mother. And then people, they fall backwards and say, oh my gosh. But again, it doesn't matter how you dress it up. If you don't have it, you don't have it, period. If you don't spend your time truly seeing it, the thing with feminism is that they said, we have it innate within us. We don't need to work on it. It's something that we, as a woman, we just naturally have it. It's a women's intuition. We just naturally understand. So, you know, we don't need to spend the time trying to figure it out. It's inherent. We're born with it. So that's the dodge, of course. That's the lack of integrity, saying we're unchallengeable because we don't need to show any proof because it's just something that, as a female, we have it innate within us. Whereas men know they don't have it innate, they have to work at it, they have to work hard at it to get the integrity. But we have an innate sense of integrity that is unchallengeable. That's like impermanence, saying that impermanence has an innate, inherent, permanent impermanence within it. So it's unchallengeable. So that beat back the challenge to intellectual authority in this world is what happened. And that's what knocked a lot of people out, severely knocked them out. Because during the 50s and 60s, what happened was people were starting to wake up by the efforts of Ramana Maharshi and Anandamayi Ma and other gurus all over the place, and teachers and efforts through for instance, like Christian Science was very, very, very powerful for a long time, and many different unity movements in high Christian circles of questioning the elite status of the elite intellectuals, of their true authority to, you know, guide the world, realizing, wait a minute, that they're getting us off tangentially, we're going off the tracks here. So it was challenged, and the whole thing was collapsing. The whole thing was collapsing. And then in rushed the defenses of impermanence, and under the guise of feminism, under the guise of all this victimization, equal rights, all this stuff. And now the universe, the whole system is like they threw a whole bunch of cement and patched it all up, and then people really couldn't challenge it anymore. They thought if they're challenging it, they're challenging motherhood, you know, they're challenging sisterhood. They're being discriminatory. They're being a sexist. They're being all these terrible words they're throwing at you if you challenge their integrity. Okay, so now we're back under their spell again of the intellectual elites. Challenge was beat back, unfortunately. It defended itself very vigorously there. Some of us saw through it from the very beginning. I saw through it from the very beginning. But initially I thought, hey, maybe this is a good thing. And then I suddenly realized it got hijacked and it turned into a very bad thing. It's just simply the fences. Got co-opted, usurped. But from the very beginning, its intent was to protect the intellectual elite status of this world as the guardians and the guidance of the race, of the planet, etc. And so here we are now, where people are again misdirected against, for instance, the rich people, class warfare. Whereas the rich people are not the problem. The problem is the intellectual elites don't have the integrity that we assume that they have. That's the real problem. And the bigger problem is we take them as role models of integrity. And since they're not taking up the challenge, we feel that we shouldn't either. We shouldn't take up this challenge of how is it that a permanent reminder of permanence is here, can be here? How is that possible? We say, well, these intellectual elites are not taking this up, so why should I? That's the feeling. I didn't have any fear of intellectuals at all. I felt easily they're equal, and so I just listened to what they said, and if they didn't have the integrity, I just, what are you talking about? You know. But it's tough for people who feel, that this is, that the intellectual elite are the high echelons in this world, way above the politicians, really. So they have enormous influence through many, many, many different ways, many different ways. And if they're not taking up the challenge, then most people say, well, it must not be the right thing to do. Which is why you need to come across teachers who are above them, have actual integrity, true intellectual integrity, who have taken up the challenge of genuine understanding, of genuine remembrance of reality, of permanence, who know that it's possible. In fact, who knows that we must do it. It is our one obligation, our one duty. And the only question is, how can we remember this? It's the only question. Not try and fix impermanent. How can we remember the impermanent? Because the impermanent is just a supposition that reality, the permanent, is no longer permanent. That's impermanent. Impermanence is just a supposition, hypothetical, kind of a contingency thing, as it were. Who needs to work on a contingency if we realize that no harm can ever befall permanence? Why do we need a contingency plan? Really? If you want intellectual integrity, answer that question. How can, if we know that no harm can ever befall permanence, never, why do we need to work on a contingency plan? Why? Why? Only a lunatic would do so. And we're not lunatics. Why would we need one? That's the question. It's understandable right now. We use backwards logic. We say we are working on a contingency plan, therefore reality must not be permanent. See, that's our logic. It's a premise. Is, well, we're working on it, so there must, and we're not lunatics, so it must be that it's impermanent. We're not lunatics, but we did make a whimsical, ill-advised leap into belief and faith and desire to be prime creator. That was whimsical and ill-advised and foolish. Okay, but we're not lunatics, we're not crazy, we still have our perfect integrity of reality still there. So when we say, well, we're working on this, therefore it must be so, that's faulty. That's faulty, isn't it? Doesn't mean that it must be so. It could also mean that we want it to be so, right? It could be that we're working on all this contingency plan because we want reality to be impermanent. And we want to replace it. So that's the logic I am telling you is correct. The incorrect logic is to say, we're working on this contingency plan, therefore that must mean that it's necessary, that the permanent is going to become impermanent. It's not permanent. Must be. Otherwise, why would we put all this effort in? That's that kind of logic is inaccurate. It's flawed. But if we turn around and say, we're working on this contingency plan because we hope, we desire, we wish, we want reality to be impermanent so that we can be prime creator, then that changes everything. Because then we say, well, yeah, but what if we can't succeed at this? What if we can't succeed? What if there isn't any power to make reality impermanent? Then all this stuff we're working on is just a waste of time. Just a waste of time. And that's a fact. It's just simply a waste of time. Our time idly spent. Nothing more than that. Just time idly spent. We've just been fooling around doing nothing, really. We think we've been having fun, but it really hasn't been fun. Nobody's really having fun here. The only way to have fun is to get the nails out of the lid of your coffin. Take up the challenge and get real intellectual integrity. Real integrity. Don't need to get lost in the philosophical mazes, you know. No need for that whatsoever. Just simply to ask, how can I remember reality? How can I remember reality? My gosh. Oh, the swamps and the mazes that the intellectuals go through, the gyrations they go through is just unbelievable. Unbelievable. It's just mind-blowing. If you can bypass that all, you're way ahead of the game. That's just what I'm trying to help you do. Because I've already been through it all, and I'm saying just bypass it. Don't even pay any attention to it. It's a complete waste of time. You know, if we give it any attention, it becomes very, very intimidating. Very intimidating. Because all these systems of philosophical discourse that they have are just unbelievable. You know, what a waste of time. So when you come across right teaching, right integrity, pay attention to that. Give your time to that so you don't have so much time to spend on these others. That's one way to do it, really. You're spending all your time on right taking up the challenge. You can't spend all this time wading through all this weighty waste of time stuff. How do I remember reality? How do I remember that reality is real, that it's permanent, the permanence is permanent, the truth is true? How can I see that permanently? Because an impermanent remembrance, how can that reassure me, really? How can it be sufficient reassurance? It is temporarily reassuring, but is temporary reassurance good enough? See, those are the questions. Those on the spiritual path who take up the challenge are way beyond the intellectuals of this world in all their libraries. Way beyond it. Don't need any of those libraries. Don't need to get rid of them. For those who want to spend their time doing that, knock yourself out, you know. But it's a waste of time. Sometimes some of the elites come down off the mountaintop and say, you know what, I don't have it. You know, I want to really take up the challenge. Sometimes that happens. Eventually it will happen to everyone. This entire system in this world has been, you know, shored up to such an extent now that the people are enthralled. You know, we thought we almost had it. And that's when the whole defensive system suddenly arose up. And they threw the mother into the situation, as it were. And I was helped because Ananda Maima is a female, a mother figure. And yet she has perfect integrity. And dismissed all that. I had zero interest in any of that. So when the intellectual elites, which were all men, almost all men, when they started losing their authority, in rushed the female intellectual elites, and they said, you know, hey, we're here to save the day. We're the ones who have real integrity. But they had, you know, didn't have the same lack of integrity as the male intellectual elites. Just as bad, if not worse. Because they said, well, we just got it naturally. We don't even have to do anything. We don't need, you know, who's anyone to challenge us? Credentials? We don't need any credentials. You know, we already got it innate. We're born with it. And so that everybody kind of went back and said, whoa, we can't even challenge them at all. So we went from challenging the intellectual elites to feeling like we couldn't challenge them at all. So now we're in a position in this world where we feel we cannot challenge anything anymore. All these special interest groups are jumping up and saying, we're unchallengeable. So we can't even ask for credentials. So where's your integrity? Can't even ask for it. Cannot even ask for it. That was the defense that the egos use. It is simply, you cannot even ask for any credentials of integrity. You cannot even question them. At least the intellectual elites back in the 50s and 60s, etc., they at least put on a little song and dance of needing to justify their credentials, etc., etc. They really went through a time there where they realized that they were being outed, as it were. But right now, you can't even go that down that road at all. It's unassailable, culturally unassailable. So really, it's not possible right now, from a cultural standpoint, social standpoint, to genuinely question the integrity of the elites, the intellectual elites, the power brokers, the special interests, all this stuff in the world that is making policy for everybody else, dictating policy, really. They're dictating policy. Policy is being dictated to the world by those who are unassailable. If you try to question their credentials, you're seen as there's not even a word for it. I mean, you just don't do that. You're crazy. Who can possibly, you know, you're no longer are a member of the human race if you do that. You cannot question the credentials. So, integrity. But the gurus, the teachers, the advisors, those are part of the path of remembrance. Of what we are. Path of not trying to fix existence, but trying to remember that reality is permanent and doesn't need any fixing. They can point out the big picture, the dynamics here, without trying to challenge anybody specifically. Don't need to. It's not the point. The point is for you to take up the challenge, and don't take those others as role models. Those who they have power. Yeah, they have almost unassailable power in this world now, even though will be temporary too. But that no integrity. And integrity is something you feel within. So if you follow them, you'll be an empty suit, an empty pantsuit also. And you'll have no integrity. You'll feel this, and then you'll blame everybody else, like everybody else you think is, you feel paranoid. Like you gotta control everybody so they don't realize that, you know, you don't have this integrity, that your image is just an image. It's an empty image. The emperor has no clothes. The empress has no clothes. has no dress. The empress has no dress. You know, the emperor has no clothes. That means the intellectual elites, those that are supposedly dictating to the world from a position of integrity of what's right, they don't have any. So they have to make an unassailable right now. And it's useless to try and assail it. It's useless. What is useful is your own integrity. You have to ask yourself, do I really want to barter away my integrity for a position of power in this world? Power, influence, money, everything, all that. Feeling that, you know, I am really the model of integrity and I can dictate to others what is right and they will follow me. And, you know, all this, these intellectuals these cultural elites. If you go down that path, you're going to, what do you sacrifice or try? Your integrity. Or what do you push to the side? Your integrity. You can't get rid of it, but you can try and ignore it for a while. But then eventually it comes back and it's nagging feeling. You know, I'm a failure. I couldn't fix impermanence. I couldn't make it permanent. I'm a failure. Why did I fail? And you see these aged intellectuals, you know, a lot of them, some of them just keep on grinning. But others, just look at them and they just realize they're failures. You know, they just failed. They realize, oh my gosh, I don't have any integrity. I can't get it. It's too late. And just, horrible. So don't trade your integrity in for worldly power and elite, etc. Don't do it. That's the wrong step to take. Take up the challenge that Ananda Maima, Ramana Maharshi, Jesus Christ, Buddha, etc. present to the world. It's a challenge. How can it be possible what they're saying? Jesus, you know, stuff that Jesus, the sayings that Jesus said, you know, how can that be possible? What is he talking about? It's like a supreme challenge to us. And that's even, it's, you know, A Course in Miracles, an extreme challenge. When I read The Course in Miracles, I thought I was so smart, and I could read all the sentences, but I couldn't understand what he was talking about. So I took that as a supreme challenge. I said, why waste my time with this other stuff? It's a waste of time, because this here is a real challenge. This other stuff is just a way to present a facade of superiority. This here is an actual real challenge, because I cannot understand what he's talking about here. I still cannot 100% either, you know. It's a great challenge, but it's getting clearer for sure. And then also when you meet a person here in the world that has that perfect integrity of knowing that that reality is always real, the permanent is always permanent, truth is always true, and it's seamless. That is like a social existential challenge. It's like, wait a minute, what's going on here? It's just a conceptual thing. Like Ananda Maima was not just a conceptual thing. You're confronted with this person here, this body here. You say, what is going on here, really? How in the world do you square up things with that, you know? And you realize you got to redo your belief system, your faith. Everything has to be re-examined. You don't have to redo it so much. Re-examine it and put it in the proper context. Same with A Course in Miracles. Put it in the proper context. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of fun. And you'll gain real status. Not in this world. You'll gain the status that you never lost. You'll remember the status that you never lost, that you've always had. Freedom in reality. Freedom to flow in with essence, in the spontaneous flowing of essence, in beingness spontaneously flowing with essence. It's beyond our imagination. But you already gained that status that you never lost. You just tried to change it. And that's real status. Who wants status in this world? What is that really? Look at those people, you know, who have status in this world. Oh boy, who wants that? Really? Who really wants it? Ah. You know, it's only for lack of something better, right? It's only for lack of something better. Otherwise, we'd say, no way. Are you kidding? We don't want to be, zero status here. But to make worldly status our goal, crazy. Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures here in this world, where the moths, corrupt, and the metal rusts. Lay up your treasures in the kingdom of heaven. That is very true. Spend your time working on remembering that truth is true. Remembering reality. You remember reality, you remember what you are, because the laws of reality pertain to all of reality. So you remember the laws of reality, you remember that truth has to be true, that permanence has to be permanent. Then you will know what you are. You will know your home. When you know your home, you know what you are, because you function under these laws. That's why I emphasize, the way I emphasize is similar to A Course in Miracles, is that focus more on the laws of God, the laws of reality, on permanence, on truth, and the laws of reality, because those are the laws that you function under, those are laws that define what we are. So I don't pay much attention to saying, who am I, or what is the self, and those things. More, what is reality, really? And then accepting the fact that truth is true for all of reality means that is our home, that those are the conditions we live under. The conditions we live under define what we are, right? We can't live outside those conditions. So know the conditions of reality, know what reality is, and we will know what we are. People know how we function. And that's what we are. What we are with no functioning is nothing. I mean, it's ridiculous. It's a definition absurdum kind of thing, where it's like saying that there's a cause with no effects. That's not possible. Cause without effects is meaningless. So our self, without knowing the functioning, how we the laws we function under, is meaningless. We have to know our functioning, and our functioning functions under the laws of creation, of laws of reality. We have to know those. And another way would be to remember ourself, and then from there we can extrapolate. We know what the laws must be. You can probably do it either way. Probably do it either way. Because you say, this is how I'm functioning, so therefore I know what the laws must be. Or you can go from the direction of, I know what the laws must be, and therefore I know how I must function. Therefore, then I know myself. Truth can't be partially true, can't be half true. A half truth is no truth at all. That kind of realization. You cannot have a permanence that is impermanent, partially impermanent. Now, what is this partially? If it's permanent, that's a lot. Reality is the laws of reality apply to all, because that's what creation is. It doesn't apply to some and not to others. It's not wishy-washy. Absolute freedom, absolute permanence, absolute truth. No such endlessness. How can you have partial endlessness? You cannot. We're trying to fashion an identity in impermanence, in half-truths and impermanence and partial endlessness and partial this and partial that. We're trying to fashion an identity. We cannot fashion an identity under those circumstances. Identity is established by the laws of functioning. An identity without any functioning is meaningless. So the laws of reality functions under those laws, and that is the identity. One moment, please. Okay, major interruptance there, sorry. all right, it's probably a good time to get to wrap it up, 'cause I've got to deal with something. I don't know what it is. Just trying to continuously reinforce your motivation during a time is it's almost prohibitively difficult. Not impossibly difficult. It's never impossibly difficult. Never. Here to get on track. Never. But it's becoming more and more and more difficult. So we're just trying to give reassurance, hope, and strengthen your resolve and purpose, and continue on with that. Continue on with right effort, clarification, realizing, hey, maybe you're not so trapped. Maybe the authorities of this world are now like unassailable. The real ones. All this nonsense about attacking rich people, etc. That's a displacement. It's a displacement. You can't really question the integrity of the elites this time, because they've taken on the garb of unassailability. So we end up then displacing that desire to question the integrity, and then we put it off onto class warfare, etc., which doesn't really get us anywhere. Misplacement. So it's better to sit quietly and consider truth, and keep your energy focused on remembering reality, remembering what you are, than to go tilting after windmills right now. Don't try to assail the power structure of this planet. Don't try to tear it down. Don't question their integrity, etc. My only purpose here is to get you back on track. I'm not going after those institutions or anything. Just saying, don't waste your time doing it. You already know, okay, they lack integrity, and so don't waste your time. Go for your own integrity, your own inner integrity, which you have. You can do it. And as soon as you take up the challenge, you'll feel a sense of integrity, guaranteed. You feel a sense of integrity, and it's unmistakable. And then you're not so easily knocked off course, right? You maintain that sense of inner integrity. I'm putting right effort in. I know what I'm doing is right. I feel the integrity of what I'm doing, so I'm going to keep doing it. That is how it works. Okay? All right, so I need to depart for a while. So that'll be it for this video. Very great.